A drop of blood. That's all it's supposed to take. No needles, no waiting. Just a pinprick and a sleek little box. You insert the sample. 3 minutes later, your results. You've got cancer, negative for HIV, heart disease, hormone imbalance, a genetic disorder, an infection of some kind. Over 200 conditions diagnosed instantly. No pain, no waiting, just answers. At the head of it all is not a doctor, not a Nobel-winning scientist, but a very, very young girl, barely 20. Elizabeth Holmes is a Stanford chemical engineering dropout. In public, she wears black turtlenecks, whispers her visions to crowds, and holds a gaze that never blinks. She doesn't come to offer software, like so many in Silicon Valley. She says she's building the future of medicine, and the world believes her. Presidents sit on her board, generals endorse her, billionaires fund her, magazines call her the next Steve Jobs. Her company, Theranos, reaches a $9 billion valuation. She becomes the youngest self-made female billionaire in history. She is praised as a genius, a visionary, a pioneer for women in tech, a woman who truly believes in what she's doing. Except, behind the scenes, the machine never works. Not once. Behind the vision, the science is fiction, bursting into one of the greatest scandals the world has ever seen. Elizabeth Holmes is born in 1984 in Washington, D.C., USA. Her father, Christian Holmes, works in high-level positions at USAID, ExxonMobil, and Enron before its collapse. The kind of man used to being in rooms where decisions are made. Her mother, Noel, is a congressional committee staffer on Capitol Hill. The Holmes household, Christian, Noel, Elizabeth, has the appearance of an upper-middle-class success story, secure, well-connected. But this is only a shadow of what the family name once meant. A century earlier, one of Elizabeth's ancestors, a Jewish-Hungarian immigrant, co-founded Fleischmann's Yeast, building one of the great industrial fortunes of early America. That empire is long gone now, but the memory of it still remains. The Holmes family grows up with that weight, the pressure to reclaim a legacy. They aren't billionaires, but they act like people who used to be. And for Elizabeth, this means one thing: expectation. From a young age, she's told she's special. At 7, she declares she'll be a billionaire. By 9, she's sketching blueprints for a time machine. In high school, she studies Mandarin, joins Stanford's summer programs in genetics, and travels to China to work in research labs. Her obsession isn't medicine, it's invention, doing something big. In her college application, she writes, "What I really want out of life is to discover something new, something that mankind didn't know was possible before." In 2002, Holmes enrolls at Stanford University to study chemical engineering. She's driven, competitive, and awkwardly intense. Her professors don't describe her as brilliant, but as relentlessly focused, a machine in human form. During her first year, she files a patent for a wearable patch that can detect infections and automatically release antibiotics. It doesn't work, but it makes one thing clear. Her sights are set on healthcare. One of her mentors is Channing Robertson, a respected Stanford professor. He believes she's different. When Elizabeth comes to him in her second year with a new idea, he listens. The concept is radical and simple. What if you could run hundreds of blood tests from a single drop of blood using a portable device? She says she's always hated blood draws. Too invasive, too slow, too expensive. She believes, like many in Silicon Valley, that anything, even the human body, can be engineered. She's not interested in treating illnesses. She just wants to diagnose it. She also tells a story, repeatedly, about an uncle who died of cancer. If it had been caught earlier, she says, he might have lived. Whether the story is entirely true or not doesn't matter. It lands. In 2003, she drops out of Stanford at 19 and launches Theranos, a name she creates by crossing therapy and diagnosis. With just one semester of undergrad behind her, she convinces Professor Robertson to join her board. She opens a medical startup in a glass office in Palo Alto, California. Now, where does the money come from? Does Elizabeth have any business experience? Has she ever run a company? Ever sold anything? No. This is where the Holmes family's reputation comes into play. Connections. They belong to the right circles. Investors, former cabinet members, Ivy League donors, and venture capitalists. Silicon Valley heavyweight Tim Draper, an old family friend, writes her a $1 million check. No demo, no data, no questions. After Draper, others follow. Angel investors, venture capital firms, former government officials. Elizabeth promises disruption. And when she looks investors in the eye and talks about revolutionizing healthcare, they don't ask for proof. They write checks. In a matter of months, she goes from a 19-year-old dropout to CEO of a healthcare startup backed by millions. Elizabeth's promises are bold. The concept is revolutionary, but now it's time for Theranos to deliver. By 2010, Theranos has raised over $100 million. Elizabeth Holmes is everywhere. Forbes, Fortune, Bloomberg. She's invited to speak at Davos, at TEDMED. She's on magazine covers. But none of this is because of a functioning product. It's all built on the promise of one. That product is called the Edison. Invented in the early years of Theranos, between 2007 and 2010, the Edison is designed to run up to 200 blood tests using just a single drop of blood. It's a small, sleek box. Employees aren't allowed to describe its inner workings. Journalists aren't allowed to photograph it. Behind the scenes, the Edison has many problems. It can't reliably analyze samples. It misfires, overheats, leaks. Engineers constantly patch problems, but nothing sticks. Still, Elizabeth pushes forward. In 2013, she lands her first major deal, one that could take Theranos national. Walgreens, the U.S. retail pharmacy giant, agrees to install Theranos wellness centers inside its stores. If the tech works, Walgreens will be at the forefront of a diagnostics revolution. Walgreens executives visit Theranos headquarters, are shown slick prototypes, and walk away impressed. But they're not allowed to inspect the labs. No third-party testing. Elizabeth demands trust, and Walgreens gives it. Soon after, Theranos opens its first center in Palo Alto, California. Next comes Arizona, where Theranos strikes a deal with the state government and major insurers. Arizona becomes the first and only state to allow consumers to get Theranos tests without a doctor's prescription. It's a big win. This could have been a breakthrough. Instead, it's a breakdown. Almost immediately, strange things begin happening. A woman is told she's miscarried, but she hasn't. Another is flagged for prostate cancer. She's female. One man receives blood test results showing sodium levels so low he should be dead, but he feels fine. Another patient is told he has HIV, rushes to his doctor, only to learn he doesn't. A firefighter's blood report changes drastically between two Theranos tests taken just days apart. A retired teacher's potassium levels are so abnormal, her doctor nearly sends her to the ER. One patient's cholesterol jumps so dramatically between tests, it looks like he's aged 20 years in a week. The results don't just confuse people, they terrify them. Doctors begin checking Theranos results against standard lab tests. The discrepancies are glaring. Something is seriously wrong. Word spreads. Inside Theranos, employees already know why. The Edison can't handle most of the tests it claims to run. It's slow, unstable, and prone to error. So secretly, Theranos resorts to using modified Siemens Advia 1800 analyzers, conventional machines found in any diagnostics lab. And there's more. The drop of blood that patients provide is usually too small. So lab techs, under pressure from Holmes to deliver results, dilute the samples manually, tainting the data even further. It's lab fraud disguised as innovation. Employees know all this. So why don't they speak out? Because Theranos doesn't allow them. Elizabeth Holmes runs Theranos like a classified military project. Everything is compartmentalized. Engineers don't talk to lab techs. Lab techs don't talk to programmers. Most employees have no idea what the others are doing. The few who do, don't dare to speak. Emails are monitored. Conversations are recorded. Employees are forced to sign NDAs, some over 20 pages long. Violating them means career suicide and lawsuits. Theranos hires one of the most feared attorneys in the country, David Boies. The strategy works. Even as patients are misdiagnosed, Theranos keeps growing. By 2014, the company is valued at $9 billion. Elizabeth Holmes owns half of it. In 2013, Tyler Schultz, a recent Stanford biology graduate, joins Theranos. He's the grandson of George Schultz, one of the company's most influential board members, and a former U.S. Secretary of State. Tyler idolizes his grandfather and believes in the company, but what he finds inside shocks him. He works in lab operations and quickly discovers the truth behind Theranos. Devices failing internal quality controls, test results manipulated to meet expectations, and a machine, the Edison, that doesn't work. He raises the issue with senior management, then with HR, then, desperate, with his grandfather. But George Schultz refuses to believe it. He tells Tyler to be quiet, and when Tyler doesn't, Theranos threatens him. They send private investigators to follow him. They send legal threats. David Boies himself pressures Tyler to sign new silence agreements. Tyler is just 23, scared but unshaken. Instead, he contacts John Carreyrou, an investigative journalist at the Wall Street Journal. Carreyrou is already chasing rumors. Tyler becomes the crucial link. They communicate in secret, using burner phones and encrypted emails. Theranos finds out. Elizabeth calls the journal's editor directly. She offers exclusive access, if they kill the story. Boies threatens lawsuits, but Carreyrou moves forward. In October 2015, the Wall Street Journal publishes the bombshell. Theranos doesn't use its own machines for most of its tests. It uses third-party analyzers. The Edison is unreliable. The company is misleading doctors, patients, and investors. Holmes denies everything. She goes on CNBC. She gives interviews. She calls it a smear campaign. She says Theranos is being attacked by entrenched interests. But inside Theranos, panic spreads. In January 2016, the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, CMS, inspects Theranos's Newark, California lab. They find critical safety violations, unqualified personnel, and dangerously flawed practices. They revoke the lab's license and ban Holmes from operating labs for 2 years. The FDA, meanwhile, finds that Theranos misclassified the Edison to avoid regulation and bans it from commercial use. Walgreens, alarmed, launches its own review. It suspends the wellness centers. By mid-2016, the partnership is terminated. Walgreens sues Theranos for $140 million. The Arizona Department of Health Services follows suit, shutting down Theranos's lab in the state for regulatory violations. By late 2016, Theranos is in free fall. Top scientists quit. Board members resign. Lawsuits pile up. Investors allege fraud. In total, more than 76,000 test results are voided across Arizona and California. Theranos is done. In March 2018, the U.S. Securities and Exchange Commission, SEC, charges Elizabeth Holmes and former Theranos president Ramesh Sunny Balwani with massive fraud. Sunny is more than a business partner. He's Holmes's secret romantic partner. A former software executive with no medical background, he joins Theranos in 2009 and becomes her closest advisor, described by employees as controlling, paranoid, and volatile. The SEC alleges that Holmes and Balwani knowingly lied to investors, exaggerated capabilities, and faked data, despite knowing the technology didn't work. Holmes settles the civil charges without admitting wrongdoing. In September 2018, Theranos officially dissolves. The criminal trial begins in September 2021, after delays caused by COVID-19. Over 4 months, more than 30 witnesses take the stand, former employees, investors, lab directors, and patients. Internal emails are exposed. Test results are dissected. Holmes's defense argues she truly believed the tech would succeed, that she was guilty only of optimism. But the prosecution shows a pattern: repeated calculated deception, lies to investors, lies to doctors, lies to patients, lies to the press. On January 3, 2022, Elizabeth Holmes is found guilty on 4 counts of fraud and conspiracy. She is sentenced to 11 years and 3 months in federal prison. Sunny Balwani is tried separately. Found guilty on all 12 counts, he receives 13 years, a longer sentence due to broader charges and his operational role in running the labs. Elizabeth now finds herself at the federal prison camp in Bryan, Texas. She is serving her sentence, wearing khakis and scrubbing floors in a minimum security facility alongside over 600 other inmates. Her projected release date, August 2032. Even from prison, she's still making headlines. In early 2025, Elizabeth gave a rare prison interview. She described life behind bars as hell and torture. She continued to claim her innocence and hinted at a comeback in the medical sector. From within the prison walls, she began drafting a criminal justice reform bill centered on the presumption of innocence. Today, she continues to file new patent ideas for health tech startups, signaling that even now she hasn't given up on the dream, a dream that began with a drop of blood and ended behind bars.